The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Joining us is Myka Fox. She's no stranger to this show. She's just a stranger to good, wholesome, decent humanity.
Right. I do my best. Hi.
Hi, Myka Fox. You have a great podcast called This Week in Jackin'.
Yes, thank you.
Where people talk about what they masturbate to.
Right.
Which brings me to Mike Lawrence. Hi.
I've been on the show. I talked about my love of stepmother, stepdaughter, interracial threesomes.
Lindsay Goldworth is back with us. Hello. And Lindsay has a new podcast called Spent, which is all about money.
Yes.
And it's also how I feel after I listen to This Week in Jackin'. So let me do the introductions here. Let me first introduce Myka.
Okay.
Okay. Myka is a very funny comedian. Have you ever seen her perform?
Yeah.
Mike Lawrence?
Yes, I've known Myka for years.
I don't think you know how funny she is.
Tell him, David.
Yeah.
And
get him.
Where are you going to be performing? Are you going to be roasting The Room?
Yeah, the movie The Room, infamously bad, from what I understand. I went to see it once, but I was like too stoned and had a panic attack in the theater and had to leave. So this will be my first time sober, and I'll be roasting with Mr. Frank Conniff from Mystery Science Theater 3000.
This is a cutie. Now, they're doing one tonight.
That's tonight.
Oh, but the people listening to this.
Yeah, you blew it.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know.
But I've been asked to come. They're going to be doing it. Chris Gersbach.
Yes.
Who is a fantastic human being.
Mm-hmm.
He really is. And you're going to make fun of the movie. How do you make fun of something that's already funny?
Well, I mean, we've been doing it with the Republican debates for months now. So, you know, I think, I don't know, we'll see. Maybe it'll live on its own.
Okay. Mike Lawrence is new to this show.
Right, yeah.
He is a New York-based comedian who is writing on the upcoming season. Oh, all right, by the way, this is why I'm doing the intro. I'm going to read it and then get progressively jealous.
Okay.
So I'm going to start. This is an acting exercise for me. So first I'm going to start off condescending and patronizing.
Okay.
And then as I read your resume,
all right,
get bitter, and then start crying.
Okay.
Okay. Mike Lawrence is a New York-based comedian who's writing on the upcoming season of Inside Amy Schumer. Oh, really? And has written on the 2015 MTV Movie Awards.
You're jealous about that one?
The 2015 Webby Awards.
This is how out of touch David is. Because he starts with the big guns.
Yeah.
And then he slowly like dwindles down your IMDb page.
Wait a second. You wrote on We Have Issues on E? You bastard.
Four full episodes, known as e-programming for the first 2 weeks on your DVR.
You're also a tremendous stand-up comic. You've been on At Midnight. Your stand-up has been featured on Late Night with Seth Meyers, TBS's Conan, FX's Totally Biased, and John Oliver's New York stand-up show on Comedy Central.
Yeah.
Your half-hour special for Comedy Central aired 2 years ago, alongside the release of your album. Now, let me see if I'm pronouncing this properly.
Okay.
Sadamantium?
Nope. Not even close.
Sadamantium.
Sadamantium.
Okay. Is that
adamantium is the metal in Wolverine's claws, and I'm depressing.
Oh. Okay.
It's a pun, David.
Yeah.
You know what your people like.
My people?
Album titles now aren't about reaching as many people as possible. They're about being in as narrow a niche as possible and getting the five people that still buy CDs to purchase it.
Yes. It's a long tail.
Yeah.
How long have you been doing stand-up there, Mike?
10 years.
10 years. And when did you get funny?
2 years from now.
Where'd you start?
Florida.
And
where will I die? Florida.
Is comedy in your genes?
Yeah, my mom was a comic.
What's that like, having a mother who was a stand-up comic?
Eh, it's fine. It's weird growing up because I think a lot of people now, especially with like starting because of podcasts, a lot of comics start because of that. They look at it as just purely an art form, and I've always seen it as a business, and I think that's been healthy.
Mm-hmm. And yeah. Your mom has been doing stand-up for how long?
Well, she stopped, but she was doing it for about, like, 15 years.
Before or after you were born?
After.
How many years into your life did she become?
2 years.
So you were 2 years old, the terrible tool.
Still jealous?
No, I'm just, I find it kind of interesting, and I'm trying to make Myka jealous. This is like a menage a trois. You guys have Lindsay Goldwert is here.
What am I, chopped liver?
This is like every menage a trois I've been the victim of, where two people go off and leave me standing alone.
For once, I'd like to be in a room with three other people that not just have it be called a menage a trois, but...
Yes, I know. Such but actually, life. There are four people in this, but I don't speak French. What would...
Three other, yeah.
I don't know where. Okay, but very quickly, because I'm curious
about
this.
I think it's quat, but that sounds a little dirty, right? Quat. I don't know. Actually, I don't know French.
It's menage a quatre.
Quat. There you go.
You mean having a...
I'd be into that, you know.
Four.
Oh, I thought it was like having it with a feline.
Yes. No. It's very French.
Yes.
Invite the cat.
Pussy galore.
So Myka has this great bit about doing cocaine with her father, which is one of the funniest things. There's a level of intimacy that both you guys have had with your parents that I have never shared. Doing cocaine or seeing your mother, I don't want to do your cocaine bit, but seeing your mother do stand-up, it would be like walking into the Peppermint Lounge in L.A. And I think I'd be more comfortable seeing my mother strip than seeing her do stand-up.
At least you know she's going to make money.
How, I mean, are there tapes of your mom doing stand-up?
Yeah, and literally tapes. Yeah, that's from when I have a VHS.
Are they cringeworthy?
No, she was funny. She was good at a time, you know. I mean, I didn't like it when I was a kid because I guess some kids like stand-up, but a lot of them don't, especially live. Like, you can watch, like, specials from home, but kids hate being expected to do something, and that's all comedy is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you have to behave a certain way. It's like, no, I don't
want to. So you were 2 years old. Did your mom take you to the clubs with her?
A little bit. Not that much. I was a child of divorce, so she would perform a lot more when I was at my dad's place.
And when you went to the clubs, were you nervous for her? Did you?
No. I didn't
get it. Did you feel good when she was killing? Did you feel bad for her when she was bombing?
No. None of it.
It's a very empathetic
child.
I wanted to be home playing, you know, Super Nintendo. I didn't give a shit. I loved Beavis and Butthead was my comedy in The Simpsons. You know,
what's the most success she had? 15 years?
Yeah, maybe.
What's the most success she had as a stand-up?
She opened for like a lot of great people. She was an MC, and she headlined like certain places. She saw Todd Berry do his first ever open mic. And, you know,
oh, Florida, right?
Yeah.
So what is the Oedipal struggle going on here?
Well, I've never dated a comic, and that's a huge reason why.
Huh.
Yeah. I just, no.
I was going to, you know, now if I didn't have respect for Myka.
Oh,
Lindsay,
why pretend now?
I'd say.
Oh, they wanted to fuck me anyway, but I'm just saying. I'm glad there was a reason I got to make it seem like it was my choice.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So your parents making spectacles of themselves. My mother used to, when skateboards first came into popularity here in America, my mother used to run outside and tell kids to stop skateboarding. They're going to break their necks. And I wasn't allowed to have a skateboard. And my mother was perceived as a witch and a shrew for not letting people have fun.
Other people's children.
I was never allowed to
have.
So your mom was basically John Lithgow from Footloose.
Mm-hmm.
Nah.
Yeah. So that was my mother, like, shaming me.
Yeah.
Like, telling people, like, telling all my friends.
If my child can't have fun, nobody's children can have fun.
Well, she is kind of right about skateboards. They are kind of dangerous. That's how my mother shamed me.
Yeah, but what came right before that? Like pushing the wheel with a stick? I mean, it's all...
And you know, if she hadn't done that, you'd be saying my mom instead of my mother.
Yes.
Mother, is that? That's very motherly behavior.
Myka Fox.
Moms let you do things, mothers don't.
Myka Fox, host of This Week in Jackin'. What's the most humiliating thing your mother ever did to you in public? Like, where were you just kind of...
Oh, my God. What? No. I mean, I don't even know how to quantify that.
Or your father.
Well, my dad's not really that humiliating. He's just more embarrassing, but he embarrasses himself more than me. But my mom is...
But if he's embarrassing himself, he's embarrassing you.
I guess I could separate it. My mom was more of like a lunatic, you know, and like as like a girl, like people think you're going to be like your mom. Mm-hmm. And so I think anytime she did anything embarrassing, there's like this like, you know, she was a crazy person. She threw a fit at a car show once and had to be like dragged out by security and then like wouldn't stop screaming until my dad bought her something from a jewelry store. Like she was a known lunatic.
What did he buy her?
Who knows? I mean, we're just like, we're just in the car like, oh my God, make this end, you know?
Yeah. Anything at school? did you ever get embarrassed by your parents at school in front of other students?
I mean, she was conscious of like embarrassing us like mm-hmm. that. She would be like, she would be mad that someone would do something to us to embarrass us, but embarrass us further. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like she would scream at a teacher like, how could you, you know, punish my daughter for screaming in the middle of class? You know, like we were all crazy.
I was a pretty good dad.
So, okay. All right. Calm down.
No, I was. Because I told my kids.
They all think that.
No, I was great.
Yeah, can we call your daughter?
Well, she's not talking to me right
there
now.
There we go.
Tell her to get over it.
Yeah, you know,
I'll talk to her.
Somebody poisoned her. But when life was good, I told my kids, you know, you have to be ashamed of me, so I'm going to give you reasons mm-hmm. in a controlled. There's going to be some controlled flooding here.
Oh, okay.
So I would say, you're yawning, Mike Lawrence.
Yeah, sorry.
Am I that boring to you?
No, I'm just tired.
Of me?
No.
We worked together. Let me just tell you what I used to do to my kids. I used to say, like, when their friends were over, I would call Toby Maguire Toby McIntyre.
Yeah.
And I would do it over and over again.
Yeah.
I'd say, hey, have you seen Spider-Man with Toby McIntyre? And it would just annoy my daughter to the point where...
She doesn't talk to you now?
She doesn't talk to me anymore.
What if that's the reason why?
There's a few missing pieces.
Yeah.
Or calling espresso espresso.
Yeah.
I'd say I'm having an espresso. Mispronouncing certain words. I told my kids that Italian dressing, when we went out for dinner, I'd always order Italian.
So you're doing this on purpose, hoping
yes.
she doesn't notice what a big loser you actually
yeah.
are. Right.
I would insist that it's pronounced Italian.
My father once took us all to a Chinese restaurant and had a panic attack and said, are you sure you serve Chinese food here? And they said yes. And he was like, we're not staying here. Marilyn, we're leaving.
But he was joking around.
No, he was. My dad's full of panic at all times.
You had a panic attack. You smoked a joint and saw the room. Was
yeah.
this in L.A.?
No, this was here.
And a panic attack.
Yeah.
What caused it? The room? The marijuana?
I mean, weed, I think, always has, like, you know, some effect. But I, like, have panic attacks with or without weed. Movie theaters get me. I've been having panic attacks in movie theaters since I was a kid. Something about, like, being, like, trapped in, like, for a certain amount of time. And it's, like, dark. And there's, like, images being forced at you. You know, I don't like that kind of mind control.
I find flashing lights can often give me a lot of anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm like a Chinese... Like those Japanese school kids that had seizures from video games.
Yeah.
Do you have seizures?
I don't.
Oh.
But I relate to them.
Yeah.
Here's how to stop panic attacks.
Yeah.
Call it Italian.
What I do, Mike Lawrence, is panic attacks come from the body, not the brain. Your brain is like shaking or you're short of breath. But if you think about the gray matter, that's calm. It's not quivering. So I say, well, this is my body. And this is my brain. My body obviously has too much coffee in it, or there's something going on here, but my brain isn't wiggling and screaming or sweating. And then I take a Xanax and I calm down.
There you go.
There you go.
Mike Lawrence, we worked together on Triumph the Ancel Comic Dog special
yeah.
for Hulu, which
yeah.
people should.
Super fun.
And my impression of you. Because we had never met.
No, no, no.
What was your first impression of me when I walked into the room?
I really respected and looked up to you. You seemed like one of like the guys in charge and very funny and was like.
Were you intimidated by me?
A little bit.
Say yes, say yes.
Yeah, yeah. A little bit. Yeah. I mean, the thing was like,
this is good. I just need this. Hang
I know.
On. Hang
I
on,
can't,
ladies.
Though.
I got to do some alpha dog shit
okay.
here. Just kind of, hang on.
Well, the whole
you
thing
know,
was...
they're supposed to just say they're intimidated by you. You can't just ask, are you?
Oh, really?
Yes, that's how that works.
Okay.
Well, the whole thing was like overwhelming because they
yeah.
were like, you know, I got.
But I was calm, right?
Oh, yeah, you were very nice.
I was cool
yeah.
as a cucumber, right?
Yeah. But I don't like I don't like cucumbers. But they.
Did you think I was a seasoned professional?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Who couldn't
And I looked up your resume. You've done a lot of stuff.
And you weren't. And you thought, I can't.
I'm more jealous of you.
I can't sit around a table with this guy. He's much quicker and faster than I am, and my brain is cramming up around him. Is that? Please tell me that's what you were thinking.
Yeah, just that's in that voice.
Didn't you read his blog? His whole blog was about that.
No, it was no. Because
and what about? Did you ever think like I'll never be as fast and funny as this guy? Say yes, just please.
Yeah,
I'm old and washed up. Please say yes.
I was like, look,
do you have your eulogy written for someone to read?
I will never be as fun. But if I could get my daughter to return my phone calls, then maybe the few jokes I got in this special are just enough. Like, because I didn't expect to meet anyone on that thing. They were just like, just send stuff remotely. And then the guy was like, would you like to come in for a meeting? And then we're just there. And it felt... And like seeing, you know, Brian Reich and you and like all of these like really seasoned
It's pronounced Brian Rich. I call him Brian Reich.
Oh, okay. He's the third Reich I've met this But he's bald. He's a nice guy. But meeting all those guys and
he invented the masturbating bear.
I know.
And
you intro'd him that way.
Did I?
I think it was you or someone else did. But
I probably did.
And then I was
up, everybody. You're in the presence of Green.
I did. He invented the masturbating bear.
That's huge.
And Pimpbot.
I fully remember.
Pimpbot 5000.
Someone else invented that bear. He just took credit for it.
I don't know Pimpbot's first appearance, but the first time I remember seeing Pimpbot was with Jonathan Harris from Lost in Space, and it was the greatest thing, like, because they're both just flamboyant robots.
So Brian Rich invented the masturbating bear on Conan O'Brien.
It's one of the formative years of comedy for me was watching those sketches.
Yeah.
So I asked him. So I had this is one other thing is I want you to and just throw this in later that I just want you to know, Mr. Feldman, and then I get to say now call me David, that I cannot believe that I'm actually sitting in your presence and even trying to keep up with you. It's just it's amazing.
You know, Mr. Feldman, yes. I wasn't sure you liked me, but here I am at 5 p.m. on a Friday on Avenue B doing your podcast, and I just, you know, just you don't know what life is going to bring you. You just don't know.
Now he's spent.
Now we know what we're going to talk about on This Week in Jackie.
Mr. Feldman. Yes. You don't know what you mean to me, Mr. Feldman.
This is why we need women in the writing rooms, because it is so gay. Comedy writing is...
women in writing rooms are so gay.
I worked, you know, on Schumer, and that's mostly women.
Thank God.
Yeah, and it's amazing. It's one of the best shows on TV. Yes. And then you look at, like, every other... Like, even being in the Triumph writing room, like, you feel like you're doing something wrong. Like,
it's gay porn.
And then more and more guys were coming in that day, and each one whiter and Jewier than the last. And I'm Jewish. But it was just like, that writer's room looked like
blind submissions.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Blind submissions.
Seriously. Yeah, but you got to read them left to right. Right to left. Oh, whatever.
I love it.
We got there.
You got to read them Finkel to Steen.
Thank you.
Wine to bomb.
So, yeah. Well, I was going to ask you a question, Myka Fox.
I hope you remember it someday.
I can't. When I get...
Are we still in the intro phase of the show? It's like we're 30 minutes in and we're still in the intro phase.
I forgot to tell you when we invited you to do my show. Yeah. I suck. Yeah. I'm really bad.
Until you nail kissing his ass, we can't move forward, Mike.
It's not. I know, this podcast has the same audience of, like, if they had a podcast at the party and Eyes Wide Shut. Like, that's... It feels like to me.
What I've learned is that David can orgasm just from flattery.
It's all about...
Mr. Lawrence, you always come, but have you ever actually gone somewhere in life?
So, Myka Fox, This Week in Jack, and how long have you been doing this podcast?
I don't know. At least 15 minutes.
Now, how long have you been doing it?
About a year and a half, maybe.
What's
almost
the most
years?
Disgusting, uh-huh. And don't say me.
Well, you haven't been on the show. Oh, just person?
Yes.
Okay. No, what? What do you want?
Have you ever heard? This is what people masturbate about. Right?
Yeah, their first masturbation to their last. The fantasy that happens in their head, not so much the process.
Well, I have a very important question to ask you.
Great.
If I come on and say children, that a problem?
That's a good question.
I have been, I am the known defender of not pedophilia, but I do have sympathy for people who are pedophiles. I don't think they have control over that, and I feel bad for them. And I support, like, pedophilic art as opposed to people, like, going out to actually find a real child. So.
Now, pedophilia, you mean, like, just, like, actual, like, drawings and
yeah,
paintings?
Like, yeah.
You know, it's interesting that you bring this up.
Well, Mike did, but go on. I just want to put that out there. I didn't start the pedophilia conversation.
Well, because I did a series of interviews. Amy Berg is a director, and she made a documentary about pedophilia in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
And I forgot the name of the documentary.
Eyes Wide Shut. No.
Yeah, the Bryan Singer right. story.
Nothing
but Corey's.
I think it's called An Open Secret. I think, is that the name of it? And we did a series of interviews. I really devoted a lot of time.
The kid stays in the picture.
Well, I'm doing this. So I'm going to try to have a conversation about this movie and pedophilia, and you just keep pitching child porn titles.
Okay.
As I'm having this serious guy. And I'll act like I'm pissed off.
Okay. You get it.
So one of the things that is never discussed in this movie is that pedophilia can't be cured.
The last 5 minutes of Benjamin Button.
Please, Mike, I'm trying to, this is serious. This is a serious problem. And you're the only person I've had on this show who's talked about this. You're right that you're born that way. If you're gay,
well,
you're born.
Child's play.
I mean, I don't know.
Three men and a little lady.
I don't know if you're born that way or if there's like a trauma. I mean, I don't know that, but I do think like with any fetish, I think you're kind of stuck with it. Yeah.
And I asked a lot of people how do you cure this, and nobody has an answer. All they talk about is the problem of pedophilia. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it's a serious problem, but nobody has a solution.
Children of the pornography.
I want to apologize, Myka. Sometimes people are very immature, and they
kindergarten cop.
See, I'm so sorry.
Muppet babies.
Catch me if you can.
So, you know, there's chemical castration. And so you're saying that, and the problem is if you're a pedophile, you can't tell your shrink. If you can't even tell your shrink that you have fantasies.
Is that so?
Well, they get the shrinks. This is what from what I've read, if you tell your shrink that you have fantasies about children, they clam up and they immediately say
the big on top of short.
Stop or my mom will shoot.
All over my face. Now, Myka, first of all, I am just the host of the show. I
there will be blood.
P.T. Anderson. Prick-tease
right.
Anderson.
Yes.
So, Daniel Day Emmanuel Lewis?
Pretty woman, prettier girl.
Guys, I am trying to talk about a very serious issue.
Boys don't cry.
Okay, if you guys are not going to behave, Myka, I'm really...
I'm trying so hard, Dave. No, that was a pitch of a movie.
Oh, okay. I'm just trying to...
And the band played on.
Okay. Boys in the Hood.
Okay, please. So you believe that people should be allowed to masturbate thinking of kids?
Yeah, get the poison out.
Jersey Boys.
There you go.
And is anybody being hurt by a thought?
Dream girls.
Thoughts maybe lead to deeds, but I think like if you're somebody who hasn't
Rosemary's Baby, my fantasy.
And when people. When people molest children, there's also like a power element of that, and I don't think that really has as much to do with sex, like in the same way as rape.
Right.
So, if you can only come by looking at pictures of kids, draw a picture of a kid and come, or take a picture of yourself when you're a kid and then grow up, and then you got something to jerk to.
My Diary of Anne Frank.
Oh, come on.
My diarrhea. Did you say my diarrhea?
No, My Diary of Anne Frank. Not hers, but mine.
In spite of everything, I still believe everyone wants to masturbate to little children.
It's a camp story.
All right. Speaking of diarrhea, I thought you said my diarrhea.
No, no, no.
Okay,
no,
so
that would be distasteful.
The Diarrhea of Anne Frank is a much shorter book.
So, Triumph the Incel Comic.
It's actually how they found her.
I want to ask you a question.
Yeah.
If you wrote this joke.
Yeah.
Because it didn't make it on the Triumph the Incel Comic Dog election special on Hulu. And then Triumph was on Steve Colbert Thursday night, and he did the bit. But this bit got cut, and I want to know if you wrote, because this makes me laugh the hardest, and I fought as hard as I possibly could for this.
I'm sure it's not.
Triumph the Incel Comic is doing the books of all the candidates,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So there's a picture of, he did it on Colbert. Oh, this got cut from Colbert, too. Rand Paul's biography, Pubehead.
Yeah, not me at all.
Donald Trump's book, Pride and Prejudice. And this made me laugh so hard, and it's Mike Huckabee's biography called I've Got Diarrhea.
Nope, not
my
me.
Vision for America. I've Got Diarrhea.
No, I wish, but no.
And I laughed so hard at that. And
how many men were in a room writing that joke?
Yeah, I think Mike and I could have really punched things up a little bit.
So it made it to the studio when we did the special, and then it got cut from the show, and then Triumph went on Colbert last night. And it got cut from, for some reason, my diarrhea. I've Got Diarrhea got cut from COVID. You didn't write that?
No.
Do you know who wrote it? Because I want to send them a box of steak knives.
I don't, but I remember my favorite assignment was, they were like, we need more Trump titles. And they're like, but they have to be about, like, his fascination with Megyn Kelly's period blood.
Mm-hmm.
And I wrote 30 of those in, like, 20 minutes. And I think my favorite one was, are you going to eat that because I will? Or something like that. But there were so many just bad Megyn Kelly period blood jokes.
It's interesting that we had no female writers, isn't it?
No.
You had none? All right.
I wore a dress.
I think
Vanessa Ramos contributed.
Yes,
to
we had female writers. We did.
Writer.
I don't know, because I got my pitchfork in the car. And kidding, I don't have a car.
No, I
no Latino writers and lots of Rubio and Cruz jokes.
Yeah.
See that.
We had Vanessa Ramos.
No people of color, because Ben Carson's not really a candidate.
Nah.
Right. He's just an Ambien taker.
Who's funny these days, Myka Fox? I saw you do stand-up the other night. Did you get my email?
Yeah, I'm so sorry I didn't respond. I got it when I was, like, you know, like, falling asleep, and then, you know, I forget to respond to emails. But that was very kind
of you.
Very funny.
And I bombed. I got mad at a...
Oh, no, you did.
I got mad at... We were doing a show. I won't tell you where it was, but somebody...
Yeah, fuck that place.
Yeah. there was a comedian who was telling an older comic that he couldn't do jokes about Caitlyn Jenner.
Ugh.
Okay.
Can you make jokes about Caitlyn Jenner? Are we allowed to make fun of Caitlyn Jenner?
A female comic wouldn't say that to someone, but a comedian would.
John Waters says you should absolutely make fun of Caitlyn Jenner.
I just think that, you know, if I'm willing to get all the attention that I deserve, then maybe some of it should be negative, you know, if we're actually fighting for the equality I'm supposed to represent.
That's brilliant. Impression.
That's an impression of Caitlyn Jenner's penis?
No. listen, a woman died so I could become one, okay? You cut me off, I cut her off. Who pays the price now?
I guess that's a pretty good impression.
Anyone can do, all it is, it's just Jimmy Stewart whispering in a movie theater. That's how you have to do it, Caitlyn. Why are there so many trailers?
Caitlyn Jenner says she is getting more complaints from liberals because she's a conservative than she is from conservatives for being a woman.
She's out of her goddamn mind. You can't,
she's a piece of shit.
Yeah, you can't be like against gay marriage and be trans. It's like, you know, if it weren't for gay people leading the way, you would be murdered by now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So
shut
people
the fuck are willing
up.
To die for her
right.
and shit. Yeah.
Like, she's the worst kind of attention whore. She's a rich person first and like a woman seventh.
Listen, I support the TLGB community. I just rebranded it.
It's the TLT community.
What is TOG? What is?
No, you know, because she's the T in LGBT, you know, but I'm sure that bothers her that she's fourth.
why'd I get bumped for G? I should be first.
Could it be a mental illness?
Is what, being transgendered or being Caitlyn?
Or being conservative.
Could she? Yeah, because I do think being a Republican is a mental illness.
Yeah.
I think being a devout Christian or Jew or Buddhist or Scientologist is a mental illness.
Well, I mean, I call them victims. You know, I don't think they're mentally ill. I think they've been victimized by the society that let them think that this is normal and okay.
You, but do you
like,
think...
Like, they're like a cult, like someone who got sucked into a cult. Are they mentally like ill, or have they just been brainwashed?
Spends thousands of dollars to take improv classes.
Right.
But doesn't get a career in show business.
Sure.
I mean, yeah. Could somebody... I know that there are some people who are born in the wrong body.
Oh, no, the trans issue is a serious issue, and that's the thing people need to realize. Like, you can make... It's actually progressive to make fun of Caitlyn Jenner as a person, for her actions and thoughts and beliefs. Like, it's way less progressive to just laud her and think she's brilliant because of what she is. But if you actually look at her on her policies as who she is, that's actual progress.
Okay, back to This Week in Jackin.
Yeah.
Myka Fox.
Yeah. You nail my credits all the time, David. It's great.
It's just a great name for a podcast.
Thank you.
Credit.
I can mention Comedy Central and,
right.
And all the...
Sure. I mean, I don't work for them, but you can say that.
What is the most disturbing
right.
fantasy
that I've heard? I mean, well... you know, there is no normal, you know, it's like a judgment-free zone.
I mean, mathematically, I mean, there's normal.
Yeah, but with sex, like, it's a huge scatter plot, you know what I mean? Like, you know, obviously, like, you know, just like boobs or oral, or yeah, those are like more concentrated toward the center, but it goes pretty far out there. One of the weirdest things I've heard was from a cam girl who said that a guy asked her to wrap newspapers around her body, and that's it.
Huh.
That's interesting that someone's still in the print media.
Right.
I know.
Well, the guy said he was... He was,
that's the only person buying newspapers.
Well, he was digital with his fingers.
Well, he...
That's a bad...
I want you to put the Doonesbury strip near your pussy.
Please.
Oh, no, it's Marmaduke. Oh, that turns me off.
He fetishized fonts. He liked letters. He liked letters, and so he would request the New York Times because they use a bigger font. It was easier to see.
But that's not true.
This is...
But wouldn't you say that? It's like all the people who say
they're
voting...
Well, okay. You know what are you asking me here, David?
Well, yeah.
But you could tell a cam girl anything. I mean, if that's what you really
he's,
like, you
he,
can ask
someone paid for this girl to do that.
But
multiple
I would
times.
Do that, I would do that just... I would get off on...
Making somebody do something.
The degradation of a cam girl.
Well, now we're getting into your fantasy. So
let me see your Helvetica cunt.
Oh, I watched him struggle with it.
I know.
He was like staring down. It's coming. It's manifesting.
Yeah, it was there.
He's like Times New Roman Polanski. No.
Well, that's the last. That was the last one we were doing. Yeah. How did we miss a Roman Polanski joke in the pedophile thing? But I was like, Comic Sans. That's not even a thing.
You'll say things to piss people off. People are voting for Trump just to piss people off. Don't you think that? I mean, do you really think that somebody is?
That if you're asking for that repeatedly and you're paying for it, yeah. And you're asking a cam girl, someone who's like far away and can't judge you, I think that's a real fetish. Yeah,
okay,
I think he was genuine.
I do too.
Yeah,
see, I think women. If you don't mind my saying this, I think.
Oh, let's generalize.
Oh, I was going to say women are...
No, I'm interested.
Women are going to save the planet.
Oh, okay. Yeah, great, great, great.
I actually get off on generalizations about women. So this is amazing right now.
No, I think, well, do women have more bizarre fantasies than, say, guys do? In your studies on the show.
Oh, no. I mean, most... I don't know how honest people really are with their extreme fantasies on my show. People tend to, like, choose the more normal.
The podcast-friendly one.
Yeah, I think, you know, like, there is a certain level where it is a comedy podcast and it's run by comedians. And though, obviously, we'd love to hear, like, the more extreme things. I think people do sand off the edges of what they're into. Some people are, you know, some people will admit, like, oh, I'm into, like, incest stuff or like whatever, you know, like people are honest, but it never gets too far. And I find it's pretty balanced between men and women.
Do you find that women have more of a narrative and guys just have what they like see more like what they see or hear?
Oh, sure. I mean, you know, we've had maybe two guys mention erotica versus like almost every woman mentions it. So yeah, like, you know, definitely storyline is much more interesting to women, but there are plenty of men who are into it.
So
I can't watch a porn without a story.
You can't.
No.
Yeah.
Seriously?
Yeah.
See, I'm a joke guy.
Yeah.
I come in
just for the jokes. I'm weak on story.
That's a fair point. The selection of people we have are comedians. These are people who like words. These are people who like stories. You know, so we're getting these thoughtful people.
Right.
You know, I'm not just like plucking like, you know, like random Joe from Staten Island who like grew up watching, you know, porn with his dad or whatever.
Right.
What do you think if I read somewhere that 1 out of 10 Americans is on an antidepressant. Does that seem about right?
Sure.
Yeah.
And don't antidepressants kind of screw up your libido?
They can.
Well, Butrin said to not do that. But
I'm sorry, what?
Butrin, I think I was told, doesn't do that. But yeah, that they do have a history of that.
Okay, so is it fair to say that more people have messed up libidos than they did 40 years ago? Because of these antidepressants.
Oh, I mean.
And so are their fantasies getting more? Does it take more to give you a fantasy to get off now because of the antidepressants?
I definitely think porn has affected things like the accessibility and all of that, you know, like.
Yeah, I would say that has a greater impact than.
Yeah.
Because you know what it medicine. Is? It's also like.
I disagree.
You used to like. But
I disagree.
But you used to. You had to like. You could only buy stuff you were willing to let a cashier check out for you.
Right.
You know, and now that's not an issue anymore.
You can get it on your phone.
Yeah.
You could just, like, be looking at Facebook and then pornography. Like,
but that's true. Although there are fetishes that they invent because you don't have to worry about the cashier anymore. And then,
well, I mean, from what I guess, I think that these fetishes, you know, you don't make them up because you're bored. I think people realize they have them because it was there to be discovered. So, like, there was probably generations of people who have, like, very strange fetishes would never even know that gets them off because they wouldn't have been exposed
to
it.
Right. That's what, like, the iPod.
Yes.
You know, that's the beauty of Apple products.
Right.
You didn't know that you needed a calendar in your pocket until it was available.
Mm-hmm.
And like
you jerk off to calendars.
No, but there were like for example, I'm going to be totally honest with you. Like I didn't know that until I watched porn that a man lies on top of a woman and kisses her and stares her in the face as he goes up, kind of does like push-ups inside of
sex.
Her.
Missionary. You're describing missionary.
Yeah, I'm embarrassed to tell you, but
you've
that
never heard of that.
Until I saw that in porn, and I'm ashamed to tell you that's what gets me off.
Right. Until then, you were just
pissing video.
Pissing video.
Right. Nothing but German shit porn.
As mom and dad used to do it.
Well, you know.
Yeah. Okay. So, have you ever been like? Has anybody ever said to you that their wildest fantasy is a guy telling a woman that he loves her? And
I mean, we have people who like are like. Honestly, when I look at porn, I look for someone who looks like my wife. People love love. Like, love is totally still part of sex.
That's good to know.
It's nice. Yeah. That's so sweet.
Yeah.
Isn't that, they call it making love.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, oh, it's totally still part of sex, for sure.
Although I think that phrase is disgusting.
Really?
I don't like the phrase making love, I just don't.
Oh.
But I love love.
You're married, right?
I am, yes.
And you don't like, know.
No.
Well, because it implies that the love doesn't exist until you two are kind of.
No, it's just hilarious. It's just like, darling, let's make love. It just makes me laugh.
It sound like there isn't any, you know.
Oh, like until you, right.
I think I saw Top Gun when I was very young, and what Tom Cruise and Kelly McGillis were doing was making love, and I saw that movie with my parents.
No, what Kelly McGillis and Whitney Houston were doing in the trailer was making love.
Oh, right.
That was the rumor on Top Gun.
It's a good rumor. It's a good rumor. But yeah, I just, to me, like, it seems very embarrassing and like, you know.
Did you ever see Bottom Gun?
No.
It's nothing but volleyball scenes.
Or toy gun. There's no.
Let's talk about love. Are you in love, Mike Lawrence?
Yeah, married.
You make that sound like you're newly married. That's why we can assume you're in love.
And how long have you been in love?
I've been with my wife for 6 years.
And did you, can I ask you some personal questions?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. When I walked into the writing room,
yeah,
clean shaven,
yeah,
wearing khaki pants,
mm-hmm,
did I have a pee stain? And would that have turned you on if a writer walks into a room?
That's a very specific fetish.
Would that turn you
pee stained khakis.com.
Did you fall in love with her the minute you met her?
No. No, it was the third date was magical, but the first two were – the first one was okay. The second one, I was very selfish. She just came to a show, and then I went off to do another show. But the third one was actually, like, special.
Myka Fox, host of This Week in Jack.
Yes.
Do you think if you're dating – are you currently – do you mind if I ask you?
Yeah, I just started seeing someone.
Okay. If I were dating you.
Oh, right.
I see.
I said no, David.
Do you think your stand-up act, your stand-up act is better than your dating act? Because we have an act when you're dating, right?
Oh, I mean, I rarely date. It's such a waste of time to me. You know, because like every time I'm on like a date, like let's say like, you know, randomly, I'm like, I could be doing spots, I could be writing, I could be whatever.
But you meet a guy, right?
Yeah, I meet.
So you have an act, mm-hmm, when you meet a guy, right?
You know, I'm like the type, like, I don't, you met your wife off of,
OkCupid,
so off a dating app, or whatever, I don't know. But like, this is like somebody I met, like, I've been friends with for a while. I generally prefer to date people I've been friends with for a while. And so I already know, you know, like, I don't.
By the way, Amy Schumer has the greatest bit about having sex with a male friend.
Mm-hmm.
I can't believe Gary is eating my pussy. Did you see her do that?
No.
That made me laugh. And I don't know why that, and I was thinking about that the other day, because Gary was eating my, so.
So yeah. there is no real act, because if I'm dating somebody, it's usually somebody who's, who already knows me.
But have you gone out on dates?
I have. And
do you have an act when you go out on dates? And is it better than your stand-up act? Do you repeat bits?
Oh, God.
Do you repeat bits in your relationship?
Do you have
like a little patter that
No, not at all. No.
You have little like jokes to make somebody laugh during sex?
No, I don't have, I don't have a good closer.
Are you funny?
That's for sure.
Are you funny during sex?
I think I'm funniest during sex, actually.
Seriously?
Yeah, sure, why not?
What's the biggest laugh you ever got during sex?
Oh, God. well, now it's in my act, but once someone asked me, they're like, where do you want me to come? And I was like, how about the trash can?
Oh, your vagina.
Yeah.
Well, someone in the anal.
Uh-huh.
Are you funny during sex?
No. You know, I have to at least, you know, be given 2 minutes to tell jokes. I want to be, but I'm not. I have no confidence in bed.
Is that a turnoff if a man isn't confident?
Absolutely. That's fucking disgusting.
Yeah. Really? Can a man be weak and still be sexy?
I mean, it depends on the kind of weak.
Emotionally weak.
I'm getting better.
Yeah. I
want to fuck the way Spider-Man fights crime, but I'm just not there yet.
Well, wait a second now. And I'm actually being serious here.
Yeah. I was too. I genuinely was.
Okay, so.
I really love Spider-Man.
If there's going to be. You know who was great in Spider-Man? Tobey McIntyre.
And no,
it's Tobey McGinnis.
And he's not great in it at all, and I could tell you why, but it's
fine. If. Women, I'm being serious, and I'm asking this as a question, not as a statement. If we are moving towards equality, is the man still supposed to be? Were you serious when you said he?
Yeah, I see where you're going with this. Yeah, like I mean, vulnerability is one thing. Like a complete lack of confidence isn't a turn on to me, but maybe you know, it's partner to partner specific. That's me. You know what I mean? Do I have to represent every woman and let any guy fuck me for equality?
Yes.
You know, absolutely not.
What's a turnoff? Go ahead. This is really important.
What's a turnoff?
Yeah, well, so you're saying a guy who is not, what, doesn't know what he's doing?
Doesn't know what he's doing is a turnoff, but a bigger turnoff is doesn't want to know. Or like, you know, like what, I remember once a guy said to me, this
if
guy
you're
was,
saying to a woman, okay, yeah. How much if I touch you there? How much if I touch you there?
Right.
Is this going to be more expensive? Is this going to be more expensive? Is that a turn off?
Lobster's anal. Lobster's not sex anymore.
Unless it's red lobster.
That's period sex.
With Megyn Kelly.
Myka, go ahead. So,
right.
So answer my question.
Right. Oh, right. What can you do to turn me off? I'm already turned off. David, you've already blown it.
Too much talking is I'm not so into the too much talking. Like, but like, how is this? How is that?
Yeah, permission is, I mean, but like, you know, there's a level. If you're confident, you know, I don't know.
I want everyone to come to the table with a certain set of skills.
And what are those skills?
I don't know. They just sort of should know what they're good at and just sort of be open to new ideas. But, you know, I love what you're saying. They don't want to be overconfident. Like, you're going to love this. Because chances are I probably won't if you're coming in
like
that.
Me, like, I'm not even, like, I don't even go on stage with confidence. Like, every time I'm about to go on stage, I'm like, I hope this goes well.
Yeah.
And that's how I fuck.
But what makes great sex is it's not always the most confident guy who's come in and, like, studied all the books. That's not been the greatest sex I've ever had. It's just, you know, I don't know. Sometimes chemistry with somebody, I don't know. It's hard to explain. You know, I think that you just have some guys like a woman that's more dominating, and they could be real aggressive jerks during the day. So I think what happens in bed is very different than what happens in real life in terms of equality. It's just whatever gets you off.
Do you think sex has changed since women have ascended?
Yeah, it's consensual.
I think you're right. Right?
Yeah, no, I'm being completely serious.
Yeah, I know.
You know, like, up until how long? It's just like, well, it's my wife. It's not rape if I married her, you know? Yeah. Like,
I bought her.
Yeah.
Here's the...
I mean, it was literally, right? The father gives the... Here, you can fuck her now.
Right, yeah, it takes 3 months' salary to have unlimited sex for the rest of your life. Yeah.
Explain to my male listeners about the... There's no pendulum, right? I've heard a lot of guys...
Edgar Allan Poe? What is that?
I've heard a lot of guys say, well, it's going to swing back in our favor.
What? Equality?
Yeah.
Equality does not. Equality
it's
stays.
In their favor. They're already.
Right.
Yeah. Things. Explain that things.
The whole men rights activist thing is like the shittiest, most disgusting thing, and I've had to explain it to people, and I feel worse for knowing anything about it.
Yeah.
It's the worst.
Like explain. Like people are saying, well, Trump is a normal reaction to.
To having my privilege taken away.
Yeah, I mean, it generally is.
No one's privilege is going anywhere, even if Trump gets elected.
Well.
But they think it is. They think that it is, and they're very excited to have it. But it's just a dream for these people. They think
you should have the privilege to not have to live in a country where someone's talking about deporting you and they get cheered and approved of. You know.
No, I agree with you. I don't know. Well, what are these men so afraid of? Like, what's changing that makes them so worried?
They're overprivileged, and their privilege is going to be taken. It will get taken away. Their privilege is to rape people and be believed when they say that the girl's crazy. And like,
it starts
you know,
when they take your Ghostbusters film.
Right, exactly.
Myka is the only person who's been on this show who tells the truth about what's going to happen when Hillary gets elected president. Everybody else is sugarcoating it. You know, there's going to be a gender war, right?
And all men are going to be enslaved, and we're going to round them up like so many of Trump's Muslims, and we're going to put you in. I mean, a lot of men already are in prisons, but we'll get the white ones too, and we'll just round them all up.
We're going to put them all in customer service, so they'll answer our calls faster, and then we'll just keep them over the better looking ones around for when we.
But you have said, and you have. You have not qualified this. You've said it outright, and I respect you for this. We women.
We're coming for you.
We're coming for you. Yeah. Not coming.
not coming on you.
Not because of you.
We're coming for you.
Yeah. I mean, Coldplay's halftime show was the series finale of White Men.
When Beyonce took over.
Yeah, we went out on a whimper.
Right.
I was hoping it was a bang, but we're done.
I'm picking this up for my daughters and her friends, and there's no pendulum. There's not going to be like a truth and reconciliation where women say, hey, you know what? Maybe we overcorrected for we're coming for it and we're taking it and we're not apologizing for it. And that ain't going to change, right?
What, for equality? No.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're not slowing that train down.
No.
No.
Look, well, you know, and it's different than the civil rights movement with African Americans because there were some stutters. There have been stutter steps with African Americans because, as always, it's the white man who's threatened by the black man, right? And so we've – but women are not – apologizing anymore? They are taking...
I mean, I think the movements are very similar. I think I don't think, you know, like people of color, their struggle has like stopped or slowed at all either. I think everyone's still just like
I think this is much I think the trajectory of women's rights right now.
If cops start shooting women and then there's articles that say are black people funny, then we will know that they're both equal.
Right. Is it fair for me to say and I'm being honest, Myka, because you said something on the show like a month or two ago that kind of coincided with some other stuff that was going on in my life and what I was reading, and a light went on in my head, and I thought, this is a laser beam, and it ain't stopping. And there have been stutter steps with Hispanic rights and black rights, but with women's rights, I am sensing this. There is no apology anymore. Right?
What you're saying sounds absolutely batshit insane. Yeah. We've been stutter-stepping, you know, since abolition.
But I think in the past four... I say this all the time on the show. I think in the past 4 years, there's something really going on here.
Yeah, there should never have been apology. Like, if anything, we're the ones who need to apologize.
Right.
We're the assholes.
Shh.
True.
Don't.
Not, but, I mean, it's weird when 53% of the population is called a minority. Like, that something's genuinely fucked up.
I mean, women are more educated. You know, we're the ones who are more likely to start a successful business than a man.
Black women are the most educated group in our culture. Did you know that?
Yeah. And I think that all these things are – and it's definitely true that, you know, a lot of, like, boys, especially a lot of boys are underserved by, you know, in – public schools, but a lot of women have been underserved for years. And if women are suddenly catching up, it's making men feel very threatened. And women are still being paid less. They're still unable. If you want to start a company and you want to appeal to a venture capital group, they're much less likely to fund you, even though your company is much more likely to actually succeed than a dude's company. And that's out of Harvard Business School Review. And until you have people, and it's going to take a very long time to get more women to the table, to start giving women more money to do things. But it's happening, and yeah.
Is there a special place in hell for women who don't respect Madeleine Albright? No, is there
Madeleine Albright believe in hell now that she's Jewish?
That's right. She discovered she's Jewish. I just discovered Mike Lawrence was Jewish.
Wow.
That's the greatest compliment you can give a Jew.
Right. Is to not look like one.
Or not to pick up on it. But
yeah.
Madeleine Albright said there's a special place in hell. For
such a cliche.
Madeleine Albright said there's a special place in hell for women who don't take care of other women.
It's
I always like
sad.
To think that people think there's special places in hell.
Yeah.
It's hell.
Exactly. Right. There's no special places.
Yeah.
No, it is sad when women don't help. But, like, you know, they've bought in. Maybe, you know, they have some advantage in the patriarchy, and they're going to ride that out. And it's sad.
I went out with a woman last night who was telling me that she won't support Hillary Clinton because she didn't leave Bill Clinton in the 90s.
That's a young woman's.
She's 30.
Yeah, that's what.
It just really bothers her.
And they see Monica Lewinsky as the victim.
I see Monica Lewinsky as a victim.
I do too.
Yeah.
I also see Hillary as a victim in this.
I see the cigar as the ultimate.
I didn't ask for it.
You know, it's part of communism. It's real.
I wish I was back in Cuba.
But that's so anti-feminist. It's so confusing to me to like, well,
Hillary was just a power player. She was like, ah, fuck what my husband sandbagged my career. I'm going to like fight for it anyway.
Right. And I'm sure she thought about leaving him, but she sat down with some people and made some fucking power broken decisions. Like, I'm going to become a fucking senator out of this thing. That's good. I'm going to get mine.
Or maybe they have an amazing marriage. Maybe they have an incredibly successful marriage that survives. Maybe if Hillary becomes president, maybe people are going to look at Bill and Hillary and say, this is one of the greatest marriages in history.
Well, it's just a modern business relationship.
But isn't that what marriage is?
In some respects, it can be.
For isn't Clintons, for Cosbys.
Right. Well, isn't that why homosexuals want to get married? They want their love recognized, but they also know that it's a business contract. Could it be said that Bill and Hillary, when all is said and done, made their marriage work?
They made it work for them, but that's not my idea of a good marriage.
Right, but who are we to judge them?
Myka Fox, host of This Week in Jacking. Mike Lawrence, who has a resume that makes you jump.
A little older, like to have to like sack through all the "I did not have sex with this woman." That was like such a humiliating time in history to have to like watch all that. It was such a waste of time. And the Ken Starr stuff, that was like a disaster.
Well, I mean, as somebody who has a failed marriage, I kind of look at Bill and Hillary and say,
just one
so far. Okay. I kind of look at Bill and Hillary and go, hey, you know what? They made it work.
Yeah, she.
Despite the worst, I mean, everything that could go wrong in a marriage.
But they have an agreement. He cheats on her, and she finds it. You know,
no, I think that's. I'm going to push back on that. I think that's glib. I've heard a lot of people say, since 1999, since the impeachment, well, they had an agreement. Their marriage is nothing more than a business arrangement.
But I think there's a flaw in thinking that, like, you know, like if two people are in a situation and they divorce, like, that's also making it work sometimes. Like, staying together.
Of course.
That's old school thinking. Just staying together means it worked.
Absolutely.
Not necessarily. I mean, you look at, look at the Cosbys now. Like,
they made it work.
Yeah. Is Camille, like, is that the greatest, like, love story of all time?
Some people or is might it think
the,
so.
This fucking, I know, but it's fucking sad and awful.
I don't think it's fair to compare Cosby to Bill Clinton.
No,
only raped one woman, Juanita Broderick, and the rest we think.
Yeah, probably raped more.
Do you think he raped?
I mean, there's a lot of sexual allegations against him. You know, I don't know, but if I were to guess, yeah, he probably did.
I think there's nothing wrong with saying that fidelity is like the end all be all in a marriage. If you're like, listen, that's not the most important thing to me. You know, we can love each other and we can make mistakes, and that's not going to end things. I think it's different between like that was so humiliating. That time in the 90s when I was, like, in high school and college, having to watch all that, having to watch Hillary go through that, it was so mortifying.
But he didn't do that to her. The Star Report did that. Oh. I mean, he was – most men get
away – he thought he was JFK, that was going to get away with it.
Yeah. And she – an argument could be made that she probably knew what was going on, and she thought he was going to get away with it, and she had to play the role
– Yeah, I think she knew. But well, yeah.
Right? And she had to play the role of – don't you think when they were going to Martha's Vineyard after the Star Report came out and they had to put Chelsea between them?
Oh, that was so hideous.
And they weren't going to hold hands. Like like she was finally finding out for the first time that he was cheating. She knew. That was all
staged.
There
were so many allegations before Lewinsky.
But you remember, but Hillary, she just got such a raw deal. I remember there was a cover of Spy magazine in the 90s. She was wearing a dominatrix suit with her puffy headband. Like, she was just so shit on all through the 90s. Anyways, it was like this double, even if she like was letting him do his thing so she can get hers later
on. Are you going to vote for Hillary because it's her turn?
No, I'm going to vote for Hillary because she could identify all the world leaders on a map.
And what about Bernie?
I think Bernie's got. I'd sit next to him at shul.
You would sit next to him at shul?
Yeah.
Not on Yom Kippur. I think he's one of those Jews who smells bad when they fast.
Like, I got a headache already.
Where's
the good Nova? He could do the prayer over the challah.
I love Bernie just because people tell me not to vote for him the way they tell me that pro wrestling's fake. And it's like, well, I'm still going to watch it.
Yeah, no, it's all personal. I'm not anti-Bernie. Yeah. I mean, I'm one of those people that's like, vote for whoever you want. Just vote for a Democrat.
Do you fast on Yom Kippur?
No, I fast every day. I'm a modern woman.
Did you fast on Yom Kippur?
No.
Were you raised Jewish?
A little bit. I mean, you know, like... Not really. I mean, I culturally identify as Jewish, but not very religious.
All right. I got to read some questions that were written by Alex, because he'll be pissed off if I don't. How much time do we have left? We have 5 minutes.
All right. What does what? Alex want to know? What does Alex want to know?
I never make him happy.
Okay. Well.
Oh, I have some gigs to plug. Mm-hmm. Next Thursday, on February 25th, I'll be at Delancey at 8 p.m., Comedy is a Second Language.
That's a very hip show.
Let's talk a little bit about stand-up before we go.
Right.
Okay.
You have some pee on your pants.
Thank you.
So don't stand up.
So when I walked into the writer's room the first time you saw me, Mike Lawrence, did you have to pinch yourself? Did you say, I cannot believe I'm working with David Feldman?
No, it's like they said I just had to send assignments remotely. Why am I in this office? Why am I here? They said 11 to 12, and then the meeting will be from 11 to 12, and then it'll be like, oh, come in between 11 and 12, but stay the whole day. And I'm like, what am I doing here? Oh, who's that beautiful man?
Did you think I was beautiful?
No, it was a guy standing next to you. Okay.
What rooms do you normally get up in?
The stand, the creek, the cellar, every once in a while, Caroline's, Stand Up New York, New York Comedy Club.
What's tougher, making a writing room laugh or an alt room laugh? The answer is a writing room.
No, I find writer's rooms to really be easy to laugh at. But although, like, a lot of times I have the same anxiety in both places, because I often feel like the poor person in a room full of people who come from money in both places.
Do you know how much the writing room has changed? What do you prefer, writing rooms or comedy rooms?
I mean, I haven't been in that many writing rooms. Yeah, I guess I'd have to say comedy rooms.
Alt rooms or bar rooms? Or what's your favorite type of audience?
Those are synonymous.
Yeah. Okay.
Club rooms.
I mean, I guess I like bar rooms better because they're younger. I get nervous when I see older people, but they're all the same, really, as long as they speak English.
Mike, you've opened for John Oliver.
Yep.
And Marc Maron.
Mm-hmm.
If you had to, which one? If I had a gun to your head, which one?
Oh. Would you make love?
John, because Mark's going to talk about it. You think I want that 15-minute intro? He doesn't even have confidence when he fucks me.
I'm good. What did you learn from them?
A lot. I mean, John's the reason I'm a working comic. He saw me, put me on his show, and took me on the road. I learned, yeah, you could be a really nice person and still succeed and love what you do. And from Maron, you know, never to give up. Like, you know, Maron, so many people said he was done, and he found a way to not even reinvent himself, just the avenue that, you know, he would shine the most in. And so both are incredible to me.
Who have you opened for, Myka? What's the biggest name you've opened for?
I opened for Maron once. I opened for Ted Alexandro last month. You know, I'm like, I've been on showcases with like a lot of great names, but you know, I don't really tour so much.
You're both stand-ups and writers.
Mm-hmm.
Are you able to detach yourself from the material you write for shows? Are you able to kill your babies?
Yeah, I mean, you know, you go in knowing that it's for somebody else. So even if, like, your favorite stuff that you wrote doesn't get on, it's not necessarily that person's favorite stuff and it's a job. I mean, the thing I've learned about comedy is once they give you money, anything's okay. Like, if I have to get rid of stuff that I care about, or if I can't do stuff that I care about and it's a free situation, fuck that. But if you're actually getting paid to be okay with your babies dying.
Do you ever secretly wish a joke, however good it is, wasn't used so it could be in your act?
No. I feel like my act, especially now, has gotten so specific that most of the stuff would never go into the writer's room stuff.
We ran into Judah Friedlander,
mm.
and he told us a great story about Ray Romano
yeah.
being heckled. And I'm not going to do it justice, but I'll tell it in a second. What's the worst you've ever been heckled?
Oh, it was when I was just getting started, when I was working at Hot Comedy Club, and I would bark for 45 minutes in the freezing cold just to go in for 5 minutes of stage time. Mm-hmm. Be terrible because I was terrible. you know, have the audience who had been suckered into a show full of people who weren't Dave Chappelle and Jon Stewart. But they were promised that.
Yeah. David Feldman?
See me, who the person who handed them a flyer, get on stage, say something bad, and then they just straight up boo me until I'd be lit at 2 minutes, even though I was promised to be lit at 4 minutes. That's the worst.
I think you're doing stand-up wrong. You should always hope that your worst heckle is going to come next.
What's the worst heckle you've ever been?
Oh, man. The worst one ever. I did the fucking worst weekend I ever did. I was bombing so hard. And they weren't even – this is even worse than them, like, saying, like, you suck or whatever. But there was these three women in the front, and the feature had a musical closer and, like, hacky T-shirts and everything. Nice guy, but, they fucking loved him. And they hated me. And during my set, they give me their phone and ask if I could take a picture of them.
No.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Judah Friedlander told me that he was at the Cellar. It was 1 year into Everybody Loves Raymond, and Ray Romano was on stage, and he was telling jokes, and a guy in the back of the room just kept going, "Come on, Ray. Come on. You can do it.
Ugh,
come on,
terrible.
Ray.
Oh, my name. Oh, God."
It's like the worst. I'm trying to tell some jokes here. And, "Come on, Ray. You can do it. You can do," because it's like it's a third base coach trying to. He was infantilizing.
Oh, yeah. Once somebody was like, "You're not funny, but you're still cute." And I was like, "Oh, there's no recovery from, you know, like, because it's just so demeaning."
And yet, "You're hilarious, but I'm not attracted to you." Yeah. Like, best compliment ever.
Right.
Okay. So, Lindsay Goldwert is a brilliant journalist and comedian, and your new podcast is Spent.
Yes, it's going to be airing in April 15th on Tax Day.
And it's about money.
It's about money. It's about all the things we do to make money and why we're so fucked up about money, and people telling their crazy stories about how they lost it, made it, how their families fucked them up about money. And, yeah, I'm just excited to just sit down and talk to people and have a real emotional discussion about and a funny discussion about
About
money.
And where are you performing next?
I'm going to be, my show, I think I said this earlier, is going to be at Sunnyside Comedy, February 26th in Sunnyside, Queens at Maggie Mae's. It's a great show. It's a free show, but please tip the comics. And there's going to be free Guinness because it's the one-year anniversary of the bar.
I like that, tipping the comics. More people should do that.
Absolutely. Yeah, always awesome. Pass a hat.
Yeah.
And Myka Fox, This Week in Jackin.
That's right.
Who are your guests?
We've had the esteemed Mike Lawrence. We've had Ted Alexandro, Chris Gethard.
Ted actually talked about.
Yep.
Really.
Mm-hmm.
And it's once a week.
Mm-hmm.
Comics?
Comedians or people related to the sex industry we've had, or just persons of interest.
Yeah. Come on and talk about their sexual fantasies.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sickest thing you've ever heard?
I tried to talk.
Answered it.
It was, there was this guy who begged a newer comic to just say he was intimidated by him.
Oh.
That was maybe the sickest sexual fantasy.
What was the sickest sexual?
It was the man wrapped in newspapers.
But that's a beautiful thing. That's just love.
I don't know if that's it. I don't think, you know. Oh, and then also there's this guy who, like, has to suck off a horse.
And Mike Lawrence, you're working on Amy Schumer's, right?
The writing wrapped, but the season should be airing.
And
like
where
April
can we
May.
See you performing stand up?
All over the place. The MikeLawrenceComedy.com is my different tour dates. I'll be at Yonkers Comedy Club on March 31st and April 1st.
Great. And I will be at February 25th. I'll be at the Delancey, 8 p.m. Comedy is a Second Language. Thank you, guys.
Yeah, thank you.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Lindsay Goldwert joins us. She's a hysterical comedian. Also, a journalist. She's written for ABC, CBS, The New York Daily News, Fast Company, Slate, Yahoo News, and she's here to talk about a brand new podcast that will be coming to you from the Showbiz Studios here in downtown Manhattan. It's called Spent. Tell me what Spent is about, Lindsay Goldworth.
Hey there. Well, I wanted to create a podcast about money, but I find that people who listen to personal finance podcasts already have money. But I wanted to create a money podcast for people who have no money and who are mm-hmm. afraid of their money and keep all their money under their mattress or have all this credit card debt, just for idiots, for people like me. And I wanted to tell, I wanted it to be more of a storytelling podcast to get people to get on and just talk about all the ways they've fucked up. Mm-hmm. And also have someone else on with me to kind of give them some ideas of how they can make things better, but also have the people themselves talk about what they learned and do it in a way that's kind of funny and empathetic mm-hmm. as opposed to prescriptive and making people feel bad, because you already feel bad.
About money.
You just automatically feel bad. When you open up your bank account statement, you just want to throw up. And if you don't, you're probably rich.
Money is like sex, you were saying.
Well, what I was saying was...
In my case, it is sex. I have to pay for it. No.
Well, when you roll it up into those rolls, like they can be. No, I'm kidding.
Why don't strippers make change when you put a $20 bill when you try to?
I think soon the strippers are just going to have like squares and be able to just swipe your credit card like right down the their ass crack. That would be wiser, in my opinion. No, but the thing about money is that I was saying was people will feel very comfortable getting on a podcast or getting on TV and talking about how many sex partners they've had or how many sex toys they own. But if you ask them how much money they have in their savings, they're going to be like, none of your business and run away. And in a lot of ways, it still is the last taboo because you can act and look a certain way, but you're the only one that sees your bills. You're the only one that sees how fucked up things really are. And it gets, and people who've been sharing stories with me thus far have been talking about, it's never just about the way they lost money. It's about, their family and how their family raised them. Their parents were insane, had terrible relationships with money, how, a divorce totally threw them into another place. These are all stories about life experiences. They're not so much about, everyone knows what to do with their money, put it in an IRA, but most people, they're not even there yet. And most of these savings programs they seem very inaccessible to people. So
do you really think that everybody knows what to do with money?
I think the personal finance people think that people know what to do with money. But the people I speak to who are, between the ages of, 20 and 40, they're not saving for retirement. By the time they pay off their student loans, they're going to, that's why I think if there ever is student loan forgiveness, it'll be just to, so people won't be bankrupt, so that there'll be something for them when they retire. So it'll be mm-hmm. this massive crisis in 40 years of all these homeless hipsters,
right.
wandering the street. I don't know. The answers are out there. It's like losing weight. Everyone knows how to lose weight, but no one wants to do it.
Right.
The same thing with money. Everyone knows to put money away for a rainy day fund and do all these things, but it's easier said than done. It's much easier to just work out and eat healthy. It's like, well, how close do you live to healthy food? And what is your work schedule like? And it's the same thing with money. Like money is, I can go on and on, but so ask me a question.
Go on. I'm curious. No, I agree with you. I think that in relationships, couples sometimes don't want to talk about what they really want during sex.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I think the things that couples fight about, they fight about, my grandmother used to say, couples fight about shit and money, and usually money. And mm-hmm. shit being like, cleaning up the house and, you never take me anywhere. But usually that's about money in some way. Because if you say, you never clean up, it could be like, why don't we have a cleaning person? It's because we can't afford one.
Yeah, and somehow we're convinced that money is dirty and it's tacky to discuss money.
It's funny what your background is. I know that. My family always spoke pretty frankly about money. My dad grew up without any, and he was always very upfront about it. He never wanted me to grow up to be one of these women from Long Island who was given an allowance, and then their husbands would leave them for a younger woman, and they had no money. Mm-hmm. This was something my father warned me about at a way too young of an age.
He'd already prepared you that a guy was going to leave you.
Yes, he said, right, he said, don't get fat, keep it together, and make your own money, because
when he leaves you,
yes.
The marriage isn't going to work.
No, right. Clearly not. I don't have that much charisma.
Right.
But I was sort of. But he talked. He was very upfront with me about money, and he always told me what to do when he and my mother were going to die. Like when we were really young, he just really wanted us to be financially aware, and I think that is unusual.
Larry David was on Charlie Rose right after Seinfeld went into syndication. I think Larry David ended up with like $500 million.
Right.
And Charlie Rose said, well, you know, what's that like? Now you don't have to worry about money. And he said, nature abhors a vacuum. He said, up until a month ago, all I ever thought about was money. Then we got sold into syndication. $500 million is coming my way. He said, within a nanosecond, his brain was consumed by some other worry. That just because it just made room for something else to worry about.
It's a certain kind of brain. I'm not sure if it's the Jewish brain.
Well, what is money? And I say that because money is very complicated. You mentioned the Jewish brain. It's a very complicated thing in terms of investing. It's also complicated in how we deal with it, how we internalize it, and how we think of money. What do you think money is?
I mean, to me, I think money is, you know, it's when the shit hits the fan, you know, you have something saved. To me, I think of savings when I think of money. You know, then I also think of, you know, buying nice things, and you think about a home. I think about the necessities, and then you keep thinking about it, and you think about all the things you want to do in life. But I'm kind of privileged that I have a lot of the necessities covered right now. I have a job. I'm doing okay.
But why is money dirty? Why do people say it's tacky? Why do they, you're a money grubber, you're cheap, or you're profligate, you spend too much.
You know, I think
you use money to control people. What is money? Did we invent, it seems to me humans invented something to control ourselves and get things without killing each other, and it seems to be money.
I think that they're dirty, and I think a lot of that is, you know, it's loosely anti-Semitic. You know, who was the one that used to lend the money? Who's the one that used to make all these deals? You know, and that's, I think that there's something related to Judaism, you know, about money. But I also think
why did Jews lend money?
I think because they weren't allowed. They weren't allowed into other guilds. I think that they weren't. They were. Oh, that was the only business that they were allowed into.
And they weren't allowed. Other religions aren't allowed to charge interest.
Yes, I believe that's true. But I think that, I don't know, I think I always get so, I remember I once went down to Palm Beach to visit a friend, and it was so waspy and so confusing because, I don't know, in some cultures, I mean, like Jewish people, like you can tell who's rich. They want you to know, you know, there's a lot of signaling with brands and like the Mercedes and that. It's very tacky.
This was with whom?
But this isn't where I'm from on Long Island, but I went down to Palm Beach with some friends where everyone was very waspy, and it was, you know, everyone was driving a Volvo and carrying like this very non-branded. So it's the idea that you shouldn't have to flaunt it. It's like to be so rich that you don't have to act like you're rich is this whole other level of wealth.
I'm glad you mentioned this because I went to a country club in Keene, New Hampshire, where Jeb Bush was speaking.
Yeah.
And it was very wealthy.
Yeah.
And I walked into this very Protestant country club.
Yeah.
And it was puritanical. And I thought, oh, this is interesting. This is people who have either old money or lots of money, and they're not – it is an American, I think, an American tradition dating back to, you know, Cotton Mather, not to show what you have.
Yeah, there's something very British about it, you know. Like, you shouldn't have to show. People just should know who you are and just be low key. And
don't judge somebody by how much money they
exactly.
have. Now, are you saying in Palm Beach? You say in New York with Long Island Jews?
I just think it's a lot of signaling. You know, you want people to know how well you're doing. You know,
is that a function of being Jewish? Or is that the immigrant experience? Would you see that in the African American community?
Sure.
And the Hispanic community? It's the second generation coming into money.
I think
and
so.
And the pride of making it in America.
Absolutely. And, you know, it's, you know, my
nouveau riche.
Yeah. I mean, my dad, you know, came from very little, you know, and he worked so hard and he wanted to have nice things, have a nice family. I mean, my family, but then you see certain people that they want to be the center of attention. They want to be they want to be very flashy. I think it is. I don't know what the next generation is going to be like, but I think a lot of it's being the first generation to really make it in this really huge way.
Can money be a reflection of somebody's values?
Oh yeah. I mean, depending on what you invest in, my dad taught me, he said, you're better off. People are always like, oh, you should invest in green funds, invest in funds that do good for the environment or do good. And my dad said, you know, don't do that. That's a bad idea. Invest money in what's going to make you money and then donate to the things that you that you want to donate
to. So he doesn't believe in divesting from oil companies and...
I'm pretty sure that's what put me through college.
How about companies that do business with Israel? That's a new thing, to divest.
Yeah. I mean, no, I think you should. I think it's your personal politics. You know, you have to, I mean, people, there's all this, people invest in vice funds, you know, mm-hmm. they invest in, you know, cigarettes, which is obviously a terrible thing to invest in now, but cigarettes, pornography, all those things.
Right.
You know?
I always say to the people who, there's a movement on college campuses to divest in any company that does business with Israel. I always say, you know, you go ahead and don't do business with Israel. But, you know, there's some great cures for heart disease and cancer coming out of Tel Aviv.
Yeah.
You know, you got to walk the walk.
Absolutely.
And so you can't use any of the drugs that come out of it.
Absolutely. I think a lot of it's, I don't want to, you know, I was young once, you know, if you want to invest with your conscience, you know, to be kind of an economist about it rather than, you know, be emotional about it. You know, it's your money. If you want your money to grow, you're going to want to put in a place where there's growth, you know, and if you want to feel good about it, you might not make as much money.
So let's get back to money.
Yes.
Once a month, I get a statement. Everything, because of my marital situation, I'm taking over my finances, and I get a statement from Visa once a month, and I put everything on Visa.
Okay.
I just charge everything. I don't spend cash because I like to see where my money goes.
That makes sense.
It's kind of unfair sometimes to go to Starbucks and charge $2.80.
No, it's fine. You don't feel bad.
Well, it costs the money.
Starbucks is okay.
Yes. And I like to sit and look at my Visa statement. Mm-hmm. I find it's a reflection on my values. Where did I spend my money?
Absolutely.
What choices did I make last month?
Absolutely. That's really interesting. It's like your browser history.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's saying, you know, what you bought in times of what you needed for comfort, what you bought at certain times of the day, when you chose to not cook for yourself and chose to order in. You know, absolutely. The stuff you spend your money on is absolutely. But it might not even. But then again, the things you buy aren't necessarily your values. I mean, I'm a just terrible, terrible cook. I've never learned to cook.
Let me get back to money.
Let's get back to money.
I can't imagine. I'm older than you. I cannot. I cannot imagine not looking at my Visa statement and seeing where the money went.
Okay.
I'm fascinated by it.
Okay.
I just can't take my eyes off it. What does that say about me?
It says you're concerned about money. You want.
Am I concerned about? Is it that I'm cheap?
No.
Is it that I'm obsessed with money? What does it mean?
It means that money is on your mind. You're curious. You're also taking stock. You're taking stock of things at this point in your life, aren't you?
And I can't believe most people don't do that.
And people are in denial. People are in denial about the stuff they buy, the stuff they spend. People don't open their mail. I think that I wonder if there was a study about how people are more likely to pay their bills online than they are in the mail. I personally hate getting mail. I have a bit of a mail phobia. When I was younger, I once didn't open my mail for a year. Those were not good times. But I find getting bills over email much less terrifying to me.
I was there. I mean, yeah. I mean, I wouldn't go to my mailbox. I mean,
that's a real thing.
But as you get older, you begin to realize that the thing that you're postponing the most mm-hmm. is the thing that could make you happy.
Right. So what do you? So
in other words, not paying your bills. And I've been there.
Sure.
And having credit card debt, mm-hmm. and I've been there, and avoiding it.
Sure.
Makes it worse.
Yes.
Whereas when you address the thing that you're postponing, it actually creates happiness.
It does.
Because, and it's not so much self-destruction as it is a fear of happiness. Because once you get your finances somewhat under control, you have control. And anxiety, which most Americans suffer from, 99% of Americans suffer from anxiety because they're not part of the 1%. Their anxiety is about money, and anxiety stems from lack of control.
That's absolutely true. It's just people are just, it's easier to put your mail in a drawer. I mean, you know, I think things through a lot. You know, when I put something aside, I'm aware that I'm putting it aside, mm-hmm. and I know what it means to put a bill aside. It means I don't want to deal with it right now. I don't want to write out a check. And my reasons for not wanting to do that have very little to do with whether there's money in my account. It's how I'm feeling that day. It's I just don't want to deal with it, you know, or I've done enough for other people today.
Right.
It has nothing to do with the money itself.
Now, I'm in a rage today.
Okay, talk to me.
I'm in a rage. People owe me money. I've done jobs for people. I'm not getting paid. People just conveniently find ways to not pay what they owe me. So I have what are called, I believe it's called accounts receivable.
Yeah.
And they eventually get paid.
Yes.
But I get worked up because I pay my bills.
Yes.
I do. And I, so I want, you know, I feel like the guy in Goodfellas, the toupee guy who, what was his name?
Murray Wiggs.
Where's my money?
Where's my money? Where's my
money, Jimmy? Where's my money, Jimmy?
Where's my money?
Yeah. Well, you should.
Yeah. And we're all owed money. And then I kind of wrap it in some kind of Talmudic cloth where it's not just about the money. I always say my joke is it's not the principle, it's the money. But it is the principle. Not to pay somebody for their work or to delay it.
Oh, yeah.
It is the height of immorality. And I get worked up. So not only don't I have the money that's owed to me, then I'm like taking the moral high ground and my head starts spinning about like I can't believe people treat each other this way. So to me, with money, it is a language on how we treat each other for what we do for one another sometimes.
Yeah. No, my first job I ever had was at a women's magazine and I was a full-time freelancer and all my invoices just sat in this woman's box for like weeks on end. And then, and I wouldn't get paid for months. And then I finally had to walk them over to another building and they write me a check on the spot for $5,000. Their pay schedule has nothing to do with your life, you know?
Because most of the time is they're either wealthy, they were born to wealth and they don't understand that some people live paycheck to paycheck. That I understand.
Right.
I can understand somebody being the child of a billionaire who doesn't get it that people live paycheck to paycheck. To me, the worst are the self-made millionaires who don't pay their bills, who know what it's like not to have the money and still not.
Because people forget, as soon as some people have money, they forget right away. You know,
they don't forget.
Well, they don't forget, but they conveniently forget. You know, some people, you know, I was raised just always give a good tip, you know, because my father never forgot what it was like to, you know, to need money, you know. But some people did grow up that way and they can't wait to be the one that doesn't tip. You know what I'm saying? Some people also their pay schedule, their pay cycle has nothing to do with you. You know, mm-hmm. I'm not making excuses for them, but as a freelance writer who often has to wait 30, 60, 90 days to get a check for $200, I just know that I just come to expect as a freelancer as part of this whole gig economy, you're
and
just
going to
get screwed.
What is this BS of a 90 day pay cycle?
That's something they created in house. It's some they
because
have, because I don't know. It's probably convenient, more convenient for them. It probably lines up with their financial quarter. Who knows?
Because they collect interest off it.
There's, you know, I think
how many times have you tested a company and said, you know what? I have never done this, but where you actually forget that you did some work. And they're not going to pay you. There's no if you don't call, that check ain't coming.
That's happened to me a few times.
In other words, there's no way in America, mm-hmm. and I'm older than you, and I'm telling you, there was a time where you could forget that you work for somebody, and in 2 weeks a check would arrive and go, oh, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
In America today, if you're freelancing, there is no way that you don't have to ask at least three times to get paid.
Well, that's the whole thing with the gig economy. Everyone's very excited about the idea that we're all freelancers. We're all able to do our own thing. But there's no one really advocating for people like us. You know, there's no one saying, you know, you have to – there's no union for freelancers saying you have to pay these people on time or else you accrue interest and you owe them more. You know, there's no one advocating for you as a freelancer. So you have to kind of build that into your fee is, you know – the bullshit of mm-hmm. waiting around for the money and bugging people.
Right.
I've been pretty lucky that I've gotten paid eventually. You know, I'm pretty on top of that kind of thing. Right. But I just assume the worst at all times.
So money, in many ways, is how we treat one another.
I think so.
What we think of one another.
I just
consideration for others.
But I think if you know someone personally, to owe them money is pretty gross, you mm-hmm. know, if you have the money to pay them back. You know, I mean, as things could become more corporate, you know, it becomes harder to find the money and you know, trace it and where it goes and who sits there and who ends up cutting you that check.
Yeah. And what corporations do, they make it easier. They make it it's how to be hateful in a very antiseptic way.
Yeah.
When you ran a small business that made millions of dollars, you saw the results of your actions. When you laid off people, if you ran a newspaper, let's talk about journalism.
Sure.
Okay, so I worked for KRON in San Francisco. It was an NBC affiliate in the 80s,
mm-hmm.
and they had a great newsroom. It was owned by the family that owned the San Francisco Chronicle.
Okay.
Well, there were the spoiled trust fund kids from that family. I forgot. Mm-hmm. But, you know, they if they fired somebody, they saw the results. It was a locally owned business.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, KRON gets bought out by a conglomerate.
Mm-hmm.
And the decisions are being made in New York. And you can just fire somebody now with the press of the button and take 6 months to give them their severance package. And you're in Manhattan and they're in Oakland or San Francisco and you don't see or smell the results. It's become very easy now to have really cruel business practices.
I think business practices have often been very cruel. You know, I think that there's – I get, you know, a little bit – when people talk about, you know, how the great things were in the old days, you know, there was some give and take in the old days. You also didn't have to, you know, hire blacks and Jews, you know. Yeah. I don't know. Things weren't always so great. I mean, you might have been guaranteed a paycheck, but who actually got that paycheck? You know, the Daily – so I worked at the Daily News for a while, a place where I really liked, and the people were very special and very funny. And, you know, and the Daily News is locally owned. It's I believe Mort Zuckerberg still owns it.
Zuckerman.
Oh, my God. Sorry. I was thinking – I believe he still owns it. And no one's buying the paper. You know, it's just everything's changing. It has the Daily News's view of New York is different than what New York actually is. You know, it's still appealing. And I think it's changing a bit. It was appealing to this real kind of like 1960s kind of populist Irish, we love cops, we love unions, New York, which I don't think really exists in the same way anymore. Right now, the people who are buying the paper, I see people read the Daily News on the subway. They're reading the sports, they're reading the crime, but they're mostly immigrants, you know. When they lay people off, and they laid off almost, I don't even know, 70% of the staff.
Really? When was this?
I mean, over the course of the last few years. Mm-hmm. You know, it was... I mean, they made a lot of big business mistakes. I mean, it's been written about widely, you know, investing in certain things and paying for very expensive talent from the UK. It's just a shame. I think the people lose out on a good job. But a lot of my friends who lost jobs have all found jobs elsewhere, which is pretty great. But then it's the people of New York who miss out on people who are doing investigative reporting on, like, the stuff that matters to real New Yorkers about.
You went to NYU Journalism School.
Yes, I did.
Your first job out of journalism school was what?
I was a fact checker
at
New York Magazine. It was my first. I did a lot of free. Well, in 2000, when I graduated, it was the first big bubble pop. So all the people that were working in online publications all went back to the print jobs. So we had a lot of trouble finding jobs. So a lot of us were checking codes and doing stuff. I was very lucky. I got a fact checking job at New York Magazine, and I was checking one of their shopping guides, and then I was checking the front of the magazine. Which was stressful. It was a weekly magazine, and they took fact checking very seriously. And that's what helped me to become a better reporter, because you had to go through every sentence with a highlighter and make sure everything was correct.
Right. Know?
And that's the way I still look at comedy that way. I still want to fact check all my jokes.
Newspapers,
yes,
used to be a cash cow.
Yes.
Newspapers. If you owned a newspaper, it was a license to print money.
Yes.
What changed that?
I think that fewer people read newspapers. I think people are getting more of their news online. And
also the classifieds got replaced by
Craigslist, I think that's definitely true. But I also think that people just started. I used to get very impatient with a lot of the print guys at the Daily News. They'd say, why are we giving away the news for free? Who's going to buy the paper? And we would say, or my boss would say, people who buy the paper are not the people who read it online. But all these years later, I agree with the news guys, because in the end, if you can give it away for free, it's not worth paying for.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that people create news now, you know, you go for what's going to get you the biggest clicks, because the clicks are going to, you know, help you get your digital ad rates, blah, blah, blah. So everyone has the same story. And people will buy, you know, insights about things that are breaking from other agents. There's a place that just sell news insights, and everyone buys the same insights. Why there's the same news everywhere? Because it's cheaper to do that and to get these like short-term hits and wins than it is to invest in, you know, to be like the Times, you know, to invest in these 7 to 8 month investigative stories. And then everyone
loses. I think what is hurting journalism is newspapers are up against what I call like sovereign funds. A sovereign fund is like the nation of Saudi Arabia investing in Fox News or Apple. I mean, there are countries that have just unlimited resources and they can actually invest.
Yeah, look at Al Jazeera. That went well.
Qatar. Well, but it is going well. And they can – well, I'll give you an example of that. Because Qatar has all this oil money, or they used to have it before the price of oil collapsed. And they were able to build this news gathering organization – and they didn't care if they lost money,
right?
Because they had all this money, and it was a vanity project that could bring money in ways that are immeasurable. Because you have so much money, you can take on something like Al Jazeera and get it back in other ways, just like for PR, for example.
Yeah, but I think eventually they start to care. There was a great magazine out of, I think, Abu Dhabi in the early 2000s called The National. And they poached all the top talent at the Wall Street Journal, Chronicle of Higher Education. Just I had a lot of friends at the Wall Street Journal who moved to Abu Dhabi and did journalism for The National. And it was at the pleasure of the King of Jordan? I'm not 100% sure, but and they had a limitless budget and until they just didn't. And then they shuttered it, you know. And I think with Al Jazeera, why suddenly Al Jazeera is shuttering is, well, first of all, why they had the vanity to keep calling it Al Jazeera for the U.S. You should call it the American Eagle Patriotism, you know, American Flag Network. I just think that they have the money to spend until they don't. And then
you're talking about Al Jazeera America.
Yes.
Yeah, but the Al Jazeera, the world – organization.
But they were dumping so much money into Al Jazeera America. I see where my friends go. A lot of people from ABC ended up at Al Jazeera, and they had a really talented group of people over there. And the way that they were covering Paris, and the way they were covering University of Missouri, Black Lives Matter, they were covering it in a way that was very European. It was very
good,
measured. And they, you know, just kind of waiting for news to come in and then reporting, as opposed to being in the Situation Room and just like shouting, you know, in a way that's very American. But in the end, what American wants to watch something called Al Jazeera? In their mind, it's like, why don't I just watch the Al-Qaeda network? And that's really how most people think. And how can you blame them to have the hubris to not rebrand it? That's idiotic.
Yeah. But by the way, Al Jazeera is still very much in business. But Al Jazeera is kind of like the Daily News, and that Mort Zuckerman, who made a lot of money in real estate, took on. He said, "I want to own a newspaper."
Did you see what Donald Trump called Mort Zuckerman? A little businessman.
Oh, I didn't.
Oh, yeah, he's like the Daily News, Mort, you know, and because it became this real estate the real estate pissing. It's this big dick slapping fight.
So it's owned by. This is the problem when vanity projects, when a billionaire buys a newspaper because he just wants it for fun. They don't compete the way like the New York Times does. I mean, the New York Times is a publicly held company, and they have to turn a profit. And if they don't turn a profit, they got to bring in Carlos Slim from Mexico. and that's why the New York Times continues to be a world class operation, is because they have nothing else to fall back on. I think journalism is a public trust. It's not a vanity project, and there are things that the government can do to protect newspapers and magazines and local TV and radio, and that is put back the bans on how many radio stations and television stations you can own. And there used to be a time when you couldn't own a newspaper and a television station in the same market.
I think they should become not-for-profits. They should become aligned with a university or just find some other.
Seems to be the next thing. But you know what? They can be profitable if the government would allow competition. You shouldn't allow somebody to just buy up things and control the entire market. I mean, there's antitrust laws already on the book that if the Justice Department used those laws, we could have real journalism in you know, you go to a city like Buffalo, They don't have any newspapers. They don't have local radio. Local radio stations used to have newsrooms.
There's definitely a lot of local news up in Buffalo. I don't upstate. There's definitely a newspaper up in Buffalo.
Yeah, but there was a time when every radio station had a newsroom.
Right.
Those days are over.
Well, yeah, I think
that's because of the Justice Department allows somebody like Clear Channel or CBS to buy up all these radio stations. And they streamline, and then the FCC says, you know what, you can own a radio station, but you don't have – you can use the public airwaves, but you don't have to use them as a public trust. You don't – we'll just give you these airwaves, and you don't even have to do anything in return. No community programming, no news. There was a time when the government said, you want the airwaves? You have to have a newsroom. You have to serve the community.
All that talk is such an anathema to Republicans. You know, the idea that the government should have any control over all these things. It's very interesting. I was listening to this. I've been listening to this podcast about McCarthyism, and it was talking how Hearst was just made anti-Americanism, and Hollywood being a hotbed for communists, his own personal thing. And he used his publications to be his voice about his opinions. And mm-hmm. he did a lot of damage to a lot of people in their careers. And in the end, that's why you own a newspaper, you know, really. I mean, I remember Mort endorsed Romney in the Daily News, and readers were like appalled, you know, because that's so opposite to a Daily News reader. But that's why you own a newspaper, so you can... So you can say that.
Mm-hmm.
Is it the right thing to do? No, but that's why people do things. I don't know. I mean, I think things are so bad right now, and I think that so much talent is moving toward more to brands and sponsored content that I think that things are pretty grim, but I think they're going to turn around. I think that a lot of people who are moving toward the business side of things are getting the education that they're going to take back journalism. I think that now things are so bad. I think the Huffington Post has done a huge disservice making all this content free and not paying its writers. And I think it's given everyone else the idea. I compare comedy and journalism to me are very similar. It's a very seamless transition for me mm-hmm. because I said the big clubs are like the newspapers. They're venerable and they're kind of like dinosaurs, and you respect them, but you're not sure why, because when you read it, it's not as great as you thought it was. And mm-hmm. as you go there, it's not that nice. And the smaller shows, the ones that I'm on, like the bar shows, they're like blogs. Some of them are fantastic, like Deadspin or Gawker. And you're like, wow, I can't believe I'm getting all this amazing stuff for free. And some of it is just like the worst low rent garbage. But in the end, you're all getting it for free and no one's getting paid. And there's so much of it that the value is completely lost.
Yeah.
So I'm a big believer in you have to get paid for the work you do. And I'm seeing some smaller publications, a really cool publication called Belt, which they write about, kind of like the Rust Belt. Mm-hmm. They report on Ohio and Cleveland and Detroit. And it's a subscription model. And you can only – and they have a product. They have journalism and photography. You can't get it anywhere else. You have to create a model of like – in the old days, I used to read like Spin and Rolling Stone and like Sassy magazine. There were like membership had its privileges. Like you got stuff you couldn't get anywhere else. You got like presents from them. Like you wanted to be a part of this team. There's none of these brands. Like, all these brands want you to love them, but what do you get from them? You know, you have to. I think eventually there's going to have to be a subscription model, and people are just going to have to eat it. And I don't know. I think it's.
I think it actually helps people to charge. There's a tsunami of information coming your way because it's all free.
Yeah.
If I pay, like I subscribe to the New York Times,
right.
And it's very expensive. So I read my New York Times.
Exactly.
And because I'm paying for it.
Yep.
If I go online and I can read USA Today for free, that just becomes part of that second wave of information coming my way that I'm drowning under.
Sure.
If you pay for quality, you'll consume that first,
right? And you'll consume it first, and you'll be loyal to that particular outlet.
And you'll
outlet.
Be so nourished that you won't feel the need to read USA Today.
Exactly. And the other thing is like, so I once I had a job where I had to interview a lot of college graduates, and I said to them, "Where do you get your news?" And you know, some of them lied. They said, mm-hmm. "Oh, I read the New York Times every day, whatever." And the ones that were honest said, I read the New York Times, but I mostly find the links from Twitter and Facebook. And that makes sense. I mean, I don't look down on them for that. But you can see what your friends are recommending on Facebook. And they're all recommending these not so hot. You're not getting the real, you're getting very slanted, crappy news. And you're just spreading this bullshit about science and about candidates and just about things that are happening in the world, that old information being repackaged as new. So I think that if you subscribe, you're investing in that company's, you know, commitment to journalism. Like I read The Economist.
Yep.
And it's expensive, but they are amazing.
And they save you time.
Because I don't want to look anywhere else.
Why do they save you time?
Because they have their own slant on things, but that's where I get. This is the thing. This is why I subscribed to The Economist, because I clicked on a link on Twitter and I was disappointed enough times I couldn't read it.
But what The Economist does is they save you time because they write very concisely.
Yes, they write very concisely. I hate think pieces. I hate people's opinions. If I want your opinion, I'll ask for it. But I think there's this trend.
And what is the one thing that they do that nobody else does?
They don't have bylines.
Don't have bylines. That's okay. Yes. But the one thing they do is they don't give you color. They don't give you anecdotal stories. They get right to the facts.
Yeah. And I don't
want to hear how Citizens United is affecting a middle-class single mom in Detroit. I want to know what Citizens United is, the story behind it, how it happened, and what it's doing to the country as a whole. I'm so sick and tired of picking up a newspaper, and they always single out this one person to show how – I don't care. And that's the great thing about The Economist.
Because they think you have to humanize it. I always have a joke that I should take a picture of myself holding a photograph, staring out a window in case someone I know dies. It's also – I mean, I'm very cynical about news and the way the news is packaged and presented. I hate think pieces. It's not that I hate feelings. I have a lot of feelings as a person, but I just feel right now. I can't stand how it's just easier to write a quick piece about your opinion on something than it is to research a story.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll get just as many clicks as it will, you know. So after everything happens, I always say I can feel the think pieces coming on. I could feel it, you know, like today with Trump getting to a fight with the Pope. It's just going to be a barrage of nonsense. None of it has anything to do with anything. It's not going to affect the election. You know, I'm sure Trump supporters who also love the Pope,
it's just noise. Just two guys with crazy things on top of their heads arguing.
Exactly. And also just report the story. He said this, but not like what it really means. I hate when people do what we talk about when we talk about blank headline. They should literally pay Raymond Carver's estate every time they use that fucking headline. It's disgusting. I hate 10 things. I hate listicles. I hate what we mean when we say. It's just blather. Just give a real headline.
Right.
Just give people the news. It's not. I don't know. I don't know if it's. And I don't think it's just millennials wanting it to be served to them that way. I think that we're just creating cheaper product.
Lindsay Goldberg is a journalist, and her new podcast coming out of these studios is called Spent, and it's going to be money. It's going to be talking about money, and you're also a great comedian. Where can we see you doing your stand-up?
Oh, well, you can come see me on Friday the 26th. I put on a show once a month in Sunnyside, Queens at Maggie May's, which is on 41-15 Queens Boulevard. It's a great room. And we're going to be serving extra Guinness because it's the bar's anniversary. We have a fantastic lineup. And yes, I'll be there on the 26th. So definitely come and hang out. It's a free show, but we do put out a bucket and we do ask that you give a little bit of money so the comics don't resort to a life of crime.
How do people follow you on Twitter?
You can right now. You can just follow me at Lindsay Goldberg.
How do you spell Goldberg? Let's see if you can get this right.
It is it's at LINDSAYGOLDWERT.
Correct.
I did it.
Thank you. And look for Spent. We'll be plugging it.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm a big fan of this podcast too. I wish I was a little funnier on it, but you got me talking about serious stuff.
You're fantastic.
Thank you.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.